Welcome to Dental Philosophers. In today's video, I will discuss about implants, some basic concepts and techniques of implants.
So first of all, what is implant? Implant is an alloplastic material which is inserted into the bone to provide support, retention and stability to the prosthesis. In this topic, we will discuss hard and soft tissue interface with implant and we will discuss biomechanical considerations of implants. Now, first of all, we will discuss hard tissue interface. The primary goal of a successful implant placement is intimate bone to implant contact, and this contact is known as osteointegration. It can be defined histologically, it can be defined clinically. Histologically, it is defined as a direct structural and functional connection between living bone and the implant surface, and there should be no intervening soft tissue between bone and implant. And clinically, it is defined as an asymptomatic rigid fixation of an alloplastic material, that is the implant body, within the bone, which can withstand the occlusal forces. Both definitions of osteointegration as well as its factors are very important for exam point of view. What are factors of osteointegration? The implant material should be biocompatible. There should be atraumatic surgery to minimize the tissue damage. Implant should be always placed in contact with the bone. Implant should be immobile during healing phase. Viable bone should be present along the surface of implant, and an implant surface should be free of contamination with organic or any inorganic material. Atraumatic surgical technique should be used during implant surgery in an aseptic environment to minimize both chemical as well as thermal trauma to the bone. We can use sharp precision osteotomy drills at slow speed and high torque, maintaining gentle intermittent pressure and copious irrigation so that both internally and externally to reduce the heat produced and prevent injury to the bone. 47 degrees centigrade temperature should be maintained while performing an implant surgery. If temperature raises above this level, it can cause bone necrosis and failure of osteointegration. Initial stability is an important factor in maintaining osteointegration of an implant. It should be achieved and maintained for formation of bone around the implant surface. That is osteointegration. And stability depends upon, that is the implant stability depends upon the volume and quality of the bone which is in contact with the implant and length and diameter of the implant. Best stability of an implant is achieved by using a long wide diameter implant which engages into the thick superior cortical plate surrounded by dense cancellous bone and engaging a thick inferior cortical plate. Soft tissue interface of an implant. Soft tissue provides a seal or barrier against the bacterial invasion into the implant site, and it is also important for maintenance of aesthetics. What act as a seal, soft tissue seal between the implant and soft tissue surface is supracrestal connective tissue, that is 1 to 2 millimeter in height, and it is responsible for maintaining a stable interface between the soft tissues and the implant surface. The probing depth in a healthy implant patient is 1 to 2 millimeter, that is less than the total measured dimension from the crest of sulcus to the alveolar bone crest. One-stage implant versus two-stage implant surgery. One-stage implants are also known as non-submerged implants, in which implant is designed such that the coronal portion of implants extend through the gingiva as shown in the figure A. An implant may be loaded or may not be loaded immediately, may or may not be loaded immediately after placement of an implant. And in two-stage implant surgery, two surgeries are performed. It is also known as submerged implants or non-loading implants. First of all, implant is placed followed by the healing period. Then we surgically uncover the soft tissues or gingiva over the implant surface and place prosthesis over it. And in this type of implant, the implant is submerged completely within the bone under the gingiva. That is why it is also known as submerged implant, as shown in the figure C. Difference between an implant and a natural tooth. Tooth have PDL with connective tissue fibers that suspends it in the alveolar bone, while implant is in direct contact with the alveolar bone without any intervening soft tissues. Connective tissue attachment is present in natural tooth, or implant mein sirf connective tissue adherence hoti hai. The connective tissue fibers are perpendicularly inserted into the cementum of the natural tooth, while in an implant, the connective tissue fibers are more or less parallel to the implant surface. Natural tooth has good mechanical resistance, while implant has poor mechanical resistance. Natural tooth is proprioceptic, while implant is not proprioceptic, lacks proprioception. Natural tooth has shock absorbing capacity, which implant does not have. The biological width of natural tooth is supracrestal, and in implant it is subcrestal. Pressure sensitivity is high in natural tooth as compared to implant. And natural tooth crown is made up of enamel and dentin, while implant on implant we place a prosthetic crown. There is physiological mobility in a natural tooth which is not present in an implant. And if non-vertical forces are acting on a tooth, natural tooth can relatively tolerate them, but implant cannot tolerate them. It can lead to bone loss. And primary movement in the case of natural tooth is the movement of PDL, while in implant the primary movement, that is the force related movement in the case of implant, is osseous movement. That was the difference between implant and natural tooth. The load bearing capacity of an implant depends upon the number of implants placed and size of implant, arrangement and angulation of implant, and volume and quality of the bone in which implant is placed. It determines the load bearing capacity of implant. Straight line or linear arrangement of multiple implants should be avoided, as it is least resistance to the torquing forces that is caused by off-center occlusal and lateral loads, and implants should always be placed in a more curvilinear or staggered fashion. Placing one or more implants in a slightly staggered fashion provides three-dimensional stability to the implants. Types of implants. There are immediate implants that are placed at the time of extraction. There are early implants that are placed 2 months after extraction, and late implants are placed 6 or more months after extraction. Now, immediate implant versus delayed implants. Immediate implants are placed at the time of extraction, while delayed implants are placed after healing of extraction socket, that is 6 or more months. In immediate implants, there is one stage surgery, and in delayed implants, there is two stage surgery. Immediate implants are placed more apically, as they are placed at the time of extraction, than delayed implants. Immediate implants are relatively more stable than delayed implants. In immediate implants, there is more residual bone loss than delayed implants. While the placement of immediate implants, there must be no infection at the site of extraction socket. And if the infection is present, then we will prefer delayed implants. There should be no bone loss during extraction in the case of immediate implants. If bone loss occurs, then we will use delayed implants. And in immediate implants, no denture wearing is required. While in delayed implants, patients have to wear denture after extraction until implant placement. Advantages of using immediate implant is that it has shortest healing time, and it maintains the soft tissue anatomy, that is, preserves aesthetics. It preserves the interdental papilla and provides psychological support to the patient. Disadvantages of using an immediate implant is that if it is exposed to excessive occlusal forces, the long-term stability of implant is lost, and there is difference in the anatomy of the natural tooth root and implant surface. There are some requirements for delayed implant placement, that is, there should be no active infection at the time of placement of an implant. The implant should be 2 to 4 mm apical to that of the natural root of the tooth, 2 mm countersunk to the crestal bone. Extraction should be performed without bone loss. If there is more than 1 mm gap between the implant and the socket, then graft is needed. There should be atraumatic extraction, and there should be good initial stability, that can be provided by 4 mm of apex of implant seated within the bone. Implant should be placed 3 mm below the free gingival margin, and implant should be positioned 1 mm palatal to the center of extraction socket because of facial bone remodeling. Contraindications of implant placement, very important from prof point of view. There are absolute contraindications and relative contraindications. Absolute contraindications include poor patient compliance, unrealistic patient expectations, unaffordable patients, local bone diseases which includes osteopetrosis, fibrous dysplasia, chronic sclerosing osteomyelitis, poor oral hygiene, and prosthodontically unable to restore. Relative contraindications for implant placement include uncontrolled systemic diseases, that is, diabetes mellitus, osteoporosis, and AIDS. Medications like bisphosphonates, oral or IV, radiation therapy of head and neck, and chemotherapy. Some psychological and mental conditions like neurosis, schizophrenia, neurosis, phobia, hysteria, irritational fears, habits and behavioral considerations like smoking, tobacco, substance abuse, that is, drugs, and parafunctional habits like bruxism and clenching. प्री ऑपरेटिव पेशेंट असेसमेंट। अब जब इम्प्लांट का पेशेंट आया तो उसको प्री ऑपरेटिवली असेस करेंगे, इनिशियली ऑब्जर्व करेंगे और पेशेंट का इंट्रोडक्शन लेंगे। चीफ कंप्लेंट दैट इज द पेशेंट्स कंप्लेंट इन हिज और हर ओन वर्ड्स विच विल हेल्प अस टू नो द पेशेंट्स रियलिस्टिक एक्सपेक्टेशंस कि व्हाट पेशेंट इज एक्सपेक्टिंग। मेडिकल हिस्ट्री एंड मेडिकल रिस्क असेसमेंट हेल्प्स अस टू नो अबाउट द डिजीजेज और एनी कंडीशंस दैट द पेशेंट इज सफरिंग फ्रॉम एंड देन treat the patient accordingly because implants are contraindicated in some situations or some conditions. Dental history needs to be taken in the same way as we take dental history normally, and dental history will help us the capacity of an patient to bear the implant therapy. Intraoral examination is performed. In intraoral examination, we will check hard tissues and soft tissues. In hard tissues, we will check the height and width of bone and quality and quantity of bone. And in soft tissues, we can check keratinization of soft tissues, type of soft tissues, mobility of soft tissues, condition of soft tissues, which will further determine the placement of implant in that patient. Then we will accurately mount the models and look for the following, that is occlusal relationships, arch relationships, interarch space, arch form, anatomy and symmetry of the arch, pre-existing occlusal schemes, curve of Spee and curve of Wilson, number and position of the existing natural teeth, tooth morphology, wear facets on the surface of tooth, edentulous ridge relationships to adjacent teeth and opposing arches, measurements for planning future implant location and visualizing force vectors, both present and planned force vectors. This is very important, that what we will look for on the casts. How can we examine casts for an implant patient? This is very important. फिर अगर हम फोटोग्राफ्स की बात करें, कुछ एक्स्ट्रा ऑरल फोटोग्राफ्स होती हैं, कुछ इंट्रा ऑरल फोटोग्राफ्स होती हैं। एक्स्ट्रा ऑरल फोटोग्राफ्स में हम फेशियल फॉर्म, फेशियल सिमेट्री, पेशेंट्स डिग्री ऑफ एक्सप्रेशंस दे सकते हैं, पेशेंट्स अपेयरेंस दैट इज़ फेशियल फीचर्स, फेशियल हेयर, कम्प्लेक्शन, आई कलर, सब कुछ। फिर हम स्माइल लाइन देखेंगे, इंसाइजल एजेस और टूथ डिस्प्ले देखेंगे, बकल कॉरिडोर डिस्प्ले कितना है और पोटेंशियल एस्थेटिक डिमांड्स देखेंगे। Then we will perform radiographs, that is intraoral radiographs that can be periapical or occlusal radiographs, extraoral can be panoramic views or cephalometric radiographs, and imaging that is CT and CBCT. Evaluation of the following areas on radiographs is required, that is location of any vital structures that can be mandibular canal, its interior loop and extensions of the mandibular canal, mental foramen, maxillary sinus, nasal cavity and incisive foramen, bone height, root proximity or angulation of the roots of the adjacent present existing teeth, bone density and trabeculation, evaluation of the cortical bone, presence of any pathology that can be cyst or abscess, existence of any anatomical variations, cross-sectional topography or angulation that is best determined by CT or CBCT, sinus health and skeletal classification can be determined on lateral Ceph. Radiographic measurement also determines some specific clinical measurements for placement of an implant. These are the ideal measurements that are to be followed for placement of an implant. That is, implant is always placed 1 mm inferior to the floor of maxillary sinus and nasal cavity. Maxillary midline placement should be avoided because of the incisive canal. Implant is always placed 5 mm interior to the mental foramen and 2 mm superior to the mandibular canal. The distance from the adjacent implant should be 3 mm and distance from the adjacent natural tooth should be 1.5 mm. Now, prosthetic considerations while placement of an implant. The simple starting point is what need to be replaced. We should know what we are replacing. In partially edentulous patients, adjacent natural existing tooth should be examined. Its perial should also be examined. Patient's occlusion need to be examined, which includes patient occlusal relationships, occlusal schemes, cross-bite, open-bite relation, curves of occlusion, occlusal planes, wear facets, abfractions, mobility, migration, splaying, inclination, everything should be evaluated carefully. Then there is evaluation of the interarch spaces, which will, according to which we will decide whether cement retained, screw retained, bar retained prosthesis should be used. Crown root ratio should be considered carefully. Normal crown root ratio is 1:1. If the ratio is above or below this value, like 1:1 se zyada ya kam hai, to we will modify the prosthesis accordingly. And implant spacing is as a dimensional requirement should be considered. I will explain this in the next slide. And anteroposterior spread for cantilever stability is also necessary. Now, for example, we have to place a 4 mm diameter implant, one implant, ठीक है? उसके लिए हमें कितनी स्पेस चाहिए? 4 mm implant, as we have discussed previously, the distance between implant and the natural tooth should be 1.5 mm. So, we will leave 1.5 mm on each side, which means 3 mm. 3 mm and 4 mm is equal to 7 mm. So, 7 mm space is required for placement of a single implant. 4 mm का जो single implant है, उसके लिए हमें 7 mm space चाहिए. If we are placing two implants of 4 mm, then how much space will be required? We will leave 1.5 on each side, that is 3 mm. 4 mm के दो implants हैं, that is 8, तो ये हो गए 11 mm. And the distance between two adjacent implants should be 3 mm, 11 plus 3, 14 mm. So 14 mm space will be required for placement of two implants of 4 mm diameter. Anteroposterior spread determines the overdenture support of a fixed prosthesis in an edentulous arch. Anteroposterior spread is defined as the distance measured between a line drawn horizontally through the middle of anterior most implants and a line drawn horizontally from passing through the distal part of portion of the posterior most implants. The distance between these two lines is anteroposterior spread. Greater the anteroposterior spread, more stable will be the prosthesis. It is shown in the figure what is anteroposterior spread. अगर हम एक retentive bar या fixed framework use कर रहे हैं और हमने उसकी length increase करनी है to provide cantilevered support, then we will multiply the anteroposterior spread with 1.5. That will determine the additional length that we can add to our framework. In surgical treatment planning, we will determine the prognosis of implant placement or any limitation that can be due to anatomical variation or any quality or quantity of the bone in which implant is to be placed. First of all, anterior mandible. Anterior mandible is a tall, wide bone that can accommodate an implant. It is one of the best locations for placement of an implant. Excellent quality of bone, densest of the two arches. The primary surgical concerns in anterior mandible is proper angulation of implants to avoid mental foramen and mandibular canal. An implant should be placed 5 mm interior to the anterior most portion of the mental foramen and 2 mm from the mental nerve. When the mental nerve exits from the mental foramen, it curves in interior direction or phir wo peeche ko jaati hai. So that's why implant is placed 2 mm interior to the mental nerve and 5 mm interior to the mental foramen. In posterior mandible, implant should be placed at least 2 mm above inferior alveolar nerve. And the buccolingual position of the implant should also be considered. If the nerve is located near the buccal cortex, the implant should be placed lingual to the inferior alveolar nerve. And the width of the posterior mandible should also be considered. If the mandibular canal, the presence of the mandibular canal also precludes any posterior implant from engaging the inferior cortical plate, which can lessen the primary stability of an implant in posterior mandible. Attachment of myelohyoid muscles maintain the bony width on the superior aspect of the ridge. This can be deceiving as a deep lingual depression, that is the lingual undercut that is present beneath the attachment of the myelohyoid muscle, and it should be examined and palpated carefully during clinical examination. Bone quality in the posterior maxilla is poorest of any area. It is limited by a thin cortical bone at the crest of the ridge and it has least dense trabecular bone, which can result in which can affect the primary stability at the time of implant placement, and 6 months or a greater time is required for osteointegration in posterior maxilla. Proximity of maxillary sinus to edentulous ridge in posterior maxilla due to increased bone resorption or increased pneumatization of maxillary sinus. There is limited height of bone that is present between for the placement of an implant. If an adequate bone is present, we can place implant by leaving 1 mm bone between the implant and sinus. But if adequate bone is not present, we will perform sinus lift procedures to increase the quantity of bone in that area and then place implant. Anterior maxilla is most easily accessible surgically, but one of the most difficult regions for implant placement because buccal plate in this area is thin even in the case of healthy teeth, and after tooth loss, ridge resorption occurs in apical and palatal pattern, which makes ridge weaker. Residual ridge in this area is thin, angulated, and ideal implants cannot be placed in this area. It will also compromise the aesthetics of the area. Vital structures present in anterior maxilla are nasal cavity and incisive canal. Implant should be placed 1 mm short of the nasal cavity floor and should not be placed in the midline due to presence of the incisive canal. In final stages of treatment planning, all the information is gathered, that is clinical, radiographic, surgical options, and we can then decide the best prosthetic option for that area. And surgical guide template can be used for delineating embrasures, for locating implant within the tooth contour, for aligning implant along the long axis, and identifying the level of cemento-enamel junction or emergence of tooth from the soft tissues. Now, surgical preparation of an implant. First of all, we will give preoperative antibiotics, an oral dose of 2 grams of penicillin V or 1 hour preoperatively, or IV dose of 1 million units of penicillin G immediately preoperatively because it is effective immediately. And alternative medications include 600 mg clindamycin orally or IV. Implant site exposure can be accomplished in several ways, that is flapless surgery or flap surgery. Flapless surgery includes tissue elevation, which may include circular, mid-crestal or vertical releasing incision. Flapless surgery is indicated when adequate keratinized tissues is present over the ridge, and this will provide excellent post-surgical anatomy and aesthetics. And flapless surgery is indicated when one-stage implant surgery is performed. When flap is required, the incisions used are mid-crestal incision and vertical releasing incision for implant site exposure. Mid-crestal incision is made through the keratinized tissues in the midline, and don't forget to blade up against the medial and distal surfaces of the teeth adjacent to the edentulous area. In the areas of narrow keratinized zone, incision is made slightly palatal or buccal to the keratinized tissues for better soft tissue closure. And if the sulcular incision is necessary, then it should follow the contour of the sulcus. In vertical releasing incision, a number 15 blade is used for a curvy linear or beveled, that is approximately 45 degrees papilla sparing incision to eliminate the incision scar, and it must be ensured that it should extend apically enough to allow complete release of flap. Then papilla is deflected by using a periosteal elevator, and dissection is directed along the sulcular tissues to the point where it meets the crestal portion of incision, elevating sulcularly to the distal extent of incision. Once buccal flap is elevated, then palatal or lingual flaps are also reflected. And once buccal flap is reflected, a retractor is used to hold it, that is positioned against the bone inside the flap. We will prepare the osteotomy site. First of all, we will mark the preparation at the implant site with a round burr. Then 2 mm twist drills are used to establish the depth and align the implant. Then a guide pin is placed in the osteotomy site to confirm the position and angulation of implant. Pilot drills are then used to increase the diameter of the coronal aspect of the osteotomy site. Final drill, that is 3 mm twist drill, is then used to finish the preparation site, and countersink drill is used to widen the entrance of the osteotomy site that allows subcrestal placement of an implant collar and cover screw. Implant is then placed into the osteotomy site by using a handpiece or a handheld driver at the speed of 30 newtons, and a cover screw is then placed over the implant. Soft tissues are readapted and sutured. The flaps are then sutured by using some resorbable suture material, that is chromic gut or vicryl suture. Sabse pehle interior papilla ko suture karenge, then buccal aspect of the papilla is entered with a suture needle, which is then passed through the embrasure to the palatal tissues. The needle is then positioned lower to the palatal tissues and is penetrated through the embrasure to the buccal tissues. And then papilla is engaged apical to the first entry point. The vertical, uske baad phir vertical releasing incision is sutured, followed by mesial and distal sides of the abutment. And these are simple interrupted sutures tied in the same fashion as that of the first suture described. Post-operative management of implant patient. Post-operative radiograph is taken to evaluate the position of the implant and its relation to the adjacent structures. Mild to moderate analgesics are given for pain control, and post-operative antibiotics are not given. In implant surgeries, antibiotics are given preoperatively. 0.12% of chlorhexidine gluconate rinses for 2 weeks, and then patient is evaluated weekly until soft tissues wound healing is completed. That is approximately 2 to 3 weeks. If the patient wears denture, then reline the denture with a soft liner after 1 week. The healing time necessary for osteointegration of an implant varies from patient to patient and site to site, but typical healing time is 4 to 6 months.
Uncovering of the implant site for placement of prosthesis. In single-stage surgery, no uncovering is necessary. But in two-stage surgery, implant is uncovered surgically and a healing abutment is placed. The goal of uncovering is to place healing abutment, preserve keratinized tissues, and modify the form and thickness of the tissues. Soft tissue healing period after uncovering should be allowed before placement of the prosthesis. And the soft tissue healing period is typically 2 to 4 weeks. There are different methods for uncovering of implant, that is tissue punch method, crestal incision with flap reflection, tissue transfer procedure, tissue grafting, and split thickness apically repositioned flap can be used to uncover the implant surface. In tissue punch procedure, a soft tissue punch equal to or slightly larger than the diameter of an implant is removed. Implant is palpated through the soft tissues to determine its location. Then tissue punch is directly placed over the diameter or circumference of the implant and it is twisted through the soft tissue thickness. The punch is then removed along with the soft tissues and exposing the cover screw. Cover screw is removed from the implant and healing abutment is placed over the implant. The advantage of using tissue punch procedure is that it is less traumatic, no periosteum needs to be reflected, and short soft tissue healing time is required after tissue punch procedure. And there are some disadvantages, that is we have to sacrifice a portion of keratinized tissue. There is inability to visualize the bone and implant interface and inability to directly visualize the precise abutment implant interface. We cannot directly visualize the condition of an implant bone and level of osteointegration. In comparison to it, if we use crestal incision with a soft tissue flap, it will allow easy access, it will be minimally invasive, and we can directly visualize the bone surrounding the implant and we can determine the level of osteointegration. Now we will discuss implant components and their functions. First of all, implant body, which is often referred to as a fixture, is the component that is placed within the bone during first stage surgery. There are different types of implant bodies, that is threaded root form or non-threaded root form. Implant body maintains the bone structure. Implant body transmits masticatory forces to the bone and stimulates the natural process of renewal. Cover screw or healing screw is placed during healing phase of the implant surgery. A screw is placed over the superior aspect of the fixture. This is a low profile screw which facilitates suturing of the soft tissues over it in two stage implant surgery and it minimizes loads in one stage implant surgery. In second stage implant surgery, the screw is removed and is replaced by subsequent components. Healing or interim abutment is a dome-shaped screw that is placed after second stage surgery before insertion of prosthesis. It is 2 to 10 mm in length and projects through the soft tissues into the oral cavity and it may be directly screwed on into the fixture or into some system onto the abutment immediately after second stage surgery. Impression copping is used to facilitate the transfer of intraoral location of implant or abutment to the similar position on the laboratory cast. Implant analogs are made to represent exactly the top of implant fixture or abutment in the laboratory cast. Abutments are the components of implant system that screws directly onto the implant and they provide support to the prosthesis. Prosthesis retaining screws penetrate the fixed restorations and then they are screwed into the abutments. And the screws are then tightened with the screwdrivers and attach non-segmented crown to the body of implant. Titanium is the material of choice for implants because it is biologically inert and does not elicit a foreign body rejection reaction from the host tissues. Implant prosthetic options. It is very important from Viva point of view. Options for edentulous patients include implant and soft tissue supported overdentures, all implant supported overdentures and complete implant supported fixed prosthesis. For partially edentulous patients, it includes a single missing, it depends upon the number of teeth absent, a single missing tooth, two or more missing adjacent teeth, and we can use cement or screw retained crowns or bridges. Complications of implants. Any complication that can occur with surgical procedures that include pain, swelling, bleeding or infection. Positioning error of implant, that is implant placed at a compromised angulation or position, which can result in compromised bony support, soft tissue health, hygiene and aesthetics. Surgical techniques complications, which can be tear of soft tissue flap, poor closure of incision, excessive soft tissue trauma from retraction, which can result in tissue dehiscence, infection, or eventual loss of implants. Invasion of critical anatomical structures, which includes inferior alveolar nerve, which can lead to paresthesia or dysesthesia, maxillary sinus or nasal cavity, which can lead to infection in the sinuses, bone structures, which can cause dehiscence or fenestrations, and bone perforations. Mechanical complications can present as implant platform fracture or implant stuck within the bone. Incision line opening can also occur from inadequate suturing or not having tension-free closure. Anesthetic complications can occur from poor implant positioning or angulation and making proper prosthetic restoration unrealistic. Now, some prosthetic complications, that is peri-implant complication, is that when the applied load exceeds the load-bearing capacity of implant-bone interface. Soft tissue interface violation and component complications can occur, which include screws, abutments, bars or attachments. The component can fracture or can become loose.